Anne Frank, The Diary of a Young Girl. Discovered in the attic in which she spent the last years of her life, Anne Frank's remarkable diary has since become a world classic, a powerful reminder of the horrors of war and an eloquent testament to the human spirit. In 1942, with Nazis occupying Holland, a 13-year-old Jewish girl and her family fled their home in Amsterdam and went into hiding. For the next 2 years, until their whereabouts were betrayed to the Gestapo, they and another family lived cloistered in the secret annex of an old office building. Cut off from the outside world, they faced hunger, boredom, the constant cruelties of living in confined quarters, and the ever-present threat of discovery and death. In her diary, Anne Frank recorded vivid impressions of her experiences during this period. By turns, thoughtful, moving, and amusing, her account offers a fascinating commentary on human courage and frailty, and a compelling self-portrait of a sensitive and spirited young woman whose promise was tragically cut short. On April 14th, 2002, at the Holy Trinity Catholic Church in Dunkirk, Hannah Pick Gosler spoke on remembering her childhood friend, Anne Frank. Hannah Pick Gosler, a Holocaust survivor, met Frank after her family moved into the same apartment building as the Frank family in New Amsterdam in 1933. They became fast friends and were such until the Franks went into hiding when the girls were 13 years old. Hannah Pick Gosler, referred to as Hanni, or Lies in Anne Frank's The Diary of a Young Girl, currently lives in Jerusalem, and this will be one of her few stops in the United States. Her name was changed in the diary by the editors to protect her identity. The book was originally published in 1947 after being found in the attic. The Monday, June 15th, 1942 entry in her diary, which ironically is only the second date in her diary, refers to her birthday party and states, "For years, Lise Goossen, our speaker today, and Sani Hauptmann have been my best friends. Since then, I got to know others. We are together a lot, and she is now my best girlfriend. Lise is more friendly with another girl." And there are references throughout the diary to our speaker today. The first entries you'll hear are excerpts from the Anne Frank diary read by community personnel.
"Dearest Kitty, our lives were not without anxiety, since our relatives in Germany were suffering under Hitler's anti-Jewish laws. After the pogroms in 1938, my two uncles, my mother's brothers, fled Germany, finding safe refuge in North America. My elderly grandmother came to live with us. She was 73 years old at that time. After May 1940, the good times were few and far between. First, there was the war, then the capitulation, and then the arrival of the Germans, which is when the trouble started for the Jews. Our freedom was severely restricted by a series of anti-Jewish decrees. Jews were required to wear a yellow star. Jews were required to turn in their bicycles. Jews were forbidden to use streetcars. Jews were forbidden to ride in cars, even their own. Jews were required to do their shopping between 3 and 5 p.m. Jews were required to frequent only Jewish-owned barbershops and beauty parlors. Jews were forbidden to be out on the streets between 8 p.m. and 6 a.m. Jews were forbidden to go to theaters, movies, or any other forms of entertainment. Jews were forbidden to use swimming pools, tennis courts, hockey fields, or any other athletic fields. Jews were forbidden to go rowing. Jews were forbidden to take part in any athletic activity in public. Jews were forbidden to sit in their gardens or those of their friends after 8 p.m. Jews were forbidden to visit Christians in their homes. Jews were required to attend Jewish schools, etc. You couldn't do this, and you couldn't do that. The life went on. Jacques said to me, "I don't dare do anything anymore, because I'm afraid it's not allowed." Yours, Anne M. Frank. Dearest Kitty, Mr. Dussel has told us much about the outside world we've missed for so long. He has sad news. Countless friends and acquaintances have been taken off to a dreadful fate. Night after night, green and gray military vehicles cruise the streets. They knock on every door, asking whether any Jews live there. If so, the whole family is immediately taken away. If not, they proceed to the next house. It's impossible to escape their clutches unless you go into hiding. They often go around with lists, knocking only on those doors where they know there's a big haul to be made. They frequently offer a bounty, so much per head. It's like the slave hunts of the olden days. I don't mean to make light of this. It's much too tragic for that. In the evenings when it's dark, I often see long lines of good, innocent people, accompanied by crying children, walking on and on, ordered about by a handful of men who bully and beat them until they nearly drop. No one is spared. The sick, the elderly, children, babies, and pregnant women, all are marched to their deaths. We're so fortunate here, away from the turmoil. We wouldn't have to give a moment's thought to all this suffering if it weren't for the fact that we're so worried about those we hold dear, whom we can't help any longer. I feel wicked sleeping in a warm bed while somewhere out there my dearest friends are dropping from exhaustion or being knocked to the ground. I get frightened myself when I think of close friends who are now at the mercy of the cruelest monsters ever to stalk the earth, and all because they're Jews. Yours, Anne M. Frank.
Mary Bird, a girl with American citizenship, was living in Poland with her parents at the beginning of the Nazi occupation. In 1940, she was imprisoned in the Warsaw Ghetto, despite the fact that her mother was not a Jew and was, in fact, an American. In the ghetto, Mary witnessed and wrote such horrors that it is almost inconceivable that she could have kept her sanity. But she never stopped recording what the Nazis did to her family, her friends, and her neighbors. Finally, she was informed that she and her mother were to be exchanged for German prisoners, and that they would be released in Nazi custody. Her diary, which is called Warsaw Ghetto, a diary, was published. Dr. Janusz Korczak's children's home is empty now. A few days ago, we all stood at the window and watched the Germans surround the houses. Rows of children, holding each other by their little hands, began to walk out of the doorway. There were tiny tots of 2 or 3 years among them, while the oldest ones were perhaps 13. Each child carried a little bundle in his hand. All of them wore white aprons. They walked in ranks of two, calm and even smiling. They had not the slightest foreboding of their fate. At the end of the procession marched Dr. Korczak, who saw to it that the children did not walk on the sidewalk. Now and then, with fatherly solicitude, he stroked a child on the head or arm and straightened out the ranks. He wore high boots, his trousers stuck in them, and a pocket coat and a navy blue cap, the so-called Maciejówka cap. He walked with a firm step and was accompanied by one of the doctors of the children's home who wore his white smile. The sad procession vanished at the corner of Jelma and Samasha streets. They went in the direction of Gelshin Street, the cemetery. At the cemetery, all the children were shot. We are also told by our informants that Dr. Korczak was forced to witness the executions and that he himself was shot afterwards. Thus died one of the purest and noblest men who ever lived. He was the pride of the ghetto. His children's home gave us courage, and all of us gladly gave part of our own scanty means to support the model home organized by this great idealist. He devoted all his life, all his creative work as an educator and writer to the poor children of Warsaw. Even at the last moment, he refused to be separated from them. The house is empty now, except for the guards who are still cleaning up the rooms of the murdered children.
Masha Rolnukas, Lithuania, 14 years old. A Jewish girl who grew up in Vilnius, Lithuania, Masha Rolnukas was 14 years old in June of 1941 when the Nazis occupied her town and she began keeping a diary. As she writes, she and her family were doubly targeted by the Nazis because they were Jewish and because her father was a liberal lawyer who often defended the communists. As soon as the Nazis occupied Vilnius, he left to join the partisan underground. As she writes, she is on work detail at the barrack of Stutthof concentration camp. We approach one of our companions who died today. I take her frozen foot, but I can't lift it. The supervisor slaps me and puts a pair of scissors and pliers in my hands. I must undress the dead woman and take out her gold teeth. The dead woman is lying in my feet. I look and she is alive. The open eyes are moving. Supervisor hurries me to undress the woman. Timidly, I touch her and she is cold. So why these eyes? Finally, I realize that it is the little lamp on the ceiling swinging in the wind which reflects her eyes. With a shaking hand, I cut the dress. I lift the body to undress it, but it won't stand up and falls backwards. The head knocks against the floorboards with a hollow sound. I hold her close to me. In her mouth, gold teeth are shining. I cannot make myself pull them out. Having reassured myself that the supervisor isn't watching, I quickly close the mouth again with the pliers. Perhaps they won't open it to look for her teeth. You silly fool, what are you doing? Supervisor yells, and then she hits me. I fall on the body. She was just waiting for me to do that and starts hitting me with a club. She always aims for my head. It seems as if my skull is splitting in two, and she doesn't stop. There is blood all over the floor. She beat me until she herself was out of breath. In our barrack, 40 to 60 women die every day. Near the door, blue bodies are piling up. A cart to which some prisoners are harnessed arrives. Two of them take the dried up and frozen bodies by the arms and feet, swing them and throw them on the heap of naked piles. The crematory is working day and night. Next to it, heaps of bodies are piling up. Every day, nearly 1,000 people die in the camp. Early this morning, the supervisor came and told us that those who were capable of walking must get ready to leave. So this is the end. Now that freedom is quite near, I am at the end of my tether. If only I had some strength. At least some small hope of being able to drag myself along. Our hope of staying on the road for 3 days only was in vain. The days go by and we can't see the end of the road. We walk and walk. I need to be supported. I can no longer walk alone. We are given nothing to eat. I have begun to swell up. The side I sleep on during the night is completely swollen. One eye is puffed up, and I can no longer open it during the day. And my feet are awful to look at. They are so swollen that I can hardly get into the men's clogs I used to stuff with paper. In order to feel my powerlessness a bit less, and not to think of the torture that is caused by each step, I go on, mentally writing my journal.
Kim was an 18-year-old Danish boy who began his diary in 1941 when he left school and signed on as a merchant seaman. He had just fallen in love with a girl he called Honey. When he saw what the Nazis were doing to Jews, he was deeply troubled and eventually decided that he must do something to stop the oppression. In September of 1944, he joined the partisan underground. He and his compatriots were arrested by the Nazis in 1945 for their partisan activities and sentenced to death. From his prison cell, Kim kept his diary going in the form of letters to his mother, Hane, and a friend named Nita. He was executed in April 1945, just 1 month before the end. After liberation, a portion of his diary, "Dearest Mother, today I went before the military tribunal together with Jorgen, Niels, and Ludwig. We were all condemned to die. I know that you're strong and that you will be able to take this, but listen to me, Mother. It isn't enough that you are able to take it. You must also understand it. I am not of importance and will soon be forgotten. But the ideas, the life, the inspiration which filled me will live on. You will find them everywhere. In the new green of spring. In people you will meet on your way. In a loving smile. Perhaps you will also find what was of value to me. You will love it, and you won't forget me. I would have liked to grow and mature, but I will still live in your hearts, and you will live on because you know that I am in front of you on the road and not behind, as you had perhaps thought at first. You know what has always been my greatest wish and what I thought I would become. Mother dear, come with me on my journey. Don't stop at the last stage of my life, but instead stop at some of the preceding ones, and you may find something which will be of value to the girl I love and to you.
I read this in a book somewhere, and it stuck in my mind. As far as I can tell, it's true. So if you're wondering whether it's harder for the adults here than for the children, the answer is no, it's certainly not. Older people have an opinion about everything and are sure of themselves and their actions. It's twice as hard for us young people to hold on to our opinions at a time when ideals are being shattered and destroyed, when the worst side of human nature predominates, when everyone has come to doubt truth, justice, and God. Anyone who claims that the older folks have a more difficult time in the annex doesn't realize that the problems have a far greater impact on us. much too young to deal with these problems, but they keep thrusting themselves on us until finally we're forced to think of a solution. But most of the time, our solutions crumble when faced with the facts. It's difficult in times like these. Ideals, dreams, and cherished hopes rise within us only to be crushed by grim reality. It's a wonder I haven't abandoned all my ideals. They seem so absurd and impractical. Yet, I cling to them because I still believe, in spite of everything, that people are truly good at heart. It's utterly impossible for me to build my life on a foundation of chaos, suffering, and death. I see the world being slowly transformed into a wilderness. I hear the approach of thunder that one day will destroy us too. I feel the suffering of millions. And yet, when I look up to the sky, I somehow feel that everything will change for the better, that this cruelty too will end, that peace and tranquility will return once more. In the meantime, I must hold on to my ideals. Perhaps the day will come when I'll be able to realize them. Yours, Anne M. Frank.
Like the Frank family, Conan Dick Goslow was eventually arrested and sent to a concentration camp, where she later saw Anne Frank again. Fortunately for Hannah and for us, although she suffered very much, she did not share the fate of Anne Frank, but survived those terrible times. As we gather today to mourn the loss of so many lives and of what might have been, we also assemble to celebrate the story and the victory that Anne Frank's life and Hannah Pick Goslow's life represent. We celebrate that in spite of all the odds, the terrible evil of National Socialism, and the forces of darkness that did so many vicious and inhuman things in the 20th century, and which have not disappeared from our world in our time, those terrible forces have not won. They did not snuff out the light of hope and of understanding, the power of human sympathy, and of reaching out to others in their time of need. We gather to recommit ourselves to make sure that this light and this spirit continues in our time and in the time of our children and our children's children. We are assembled here then to renew that commitment in listening to Hannah Pick Goslow and the story she tells of her youth and of that of Anne Frank, so that we may gather strength to continue that never-ending struggle for humanity, for goodness, and for truth. That is the legacy left to us. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure to welcome to our community, in your name, Hannah Pick Goslow.
She was in hiding, and I, her best friend, may be already dead. And now you see me sitting here. I live in my own country, in the capital city, Jerusalem. I even brought a granddaughter, one of 10 my grandchildren with me, and Anna couldn't be 16 years old, only because she was a Jewish child. And so I feel obliged to tell about her, and through her about the Holocaust. So I was born in Germany, in Berlin, the capital city, and my father was there, a deputy to the Minister for Domestic Affairs, a very high, one of the two highest Jewish officials in the German government. And the moment Hitler came democratically to power, the whole government had to step down, and with them, my father. He took my mother and me, and we went to Holland. There he opened a little office. He was an economist. He took in a lawyer, also a refugee. This afternoon in the hotel, we saw a film about the daughter of that lawyer. She lives here in America. She was in hiding when the family was taken. And my mother, that was a teacher, she was a secretary in that little office, and they wanted to help all the refugees my father was sure will come to go on or to settle in Holland. First week in Holland, mother goes to the grocery shop with me, and she meets another woman, also a refugee, with a little girl, half a year younger than me. And both didn't know the Dutch language, so they started to speak in German. And it came out, it is Mrs. Frank with her little daughter, Anne. After some days, it came out, we live next entrance in the apartment houses where we were living. After some days, mother takes me to kindergarten. I don't know the language, I don't know anybody. And I want just to say, mother, take me home, please. I saw the back of that little girl. She was making music on little girls. And she just turns around, ran in my arms. I ran in hers, mother could go home. And from that moment on, we were friends, and through us also our parents. Much later, I think 2 years ago, I learned it was also Anne's first day in kindergarten. So she also didn't know anybody, only me from the grocery shop. The families were quite different. We were a very religious family. The Franks, Mr. Frank and Anne not. Mrs. Frank and Margot were more, were going to synagogue. My parents finished university. My father was a big pessimist. He always thought everything will be very bad in the war. The Germans will win and they will kill all of us. And Mr. Frank was a big optimist. When he came to our house, everything looked like the sun was coming up. Everything will be okay, and the Americans will help in the war, and don't be always worried. Who was right, you all know, but it was much nicer to hear Mr. Frank. And then we had a quite normal life. We went to a public school, everything was nice. I have a little bit to shorten. All Jewish holidays we did in our home. Only 31 of December, we wouldn't have at my home, we would go to the France. Next day was vacation, so I could sleep there. They would wake us up 12 o'clock. My parents also were there. We got a donut, something to drink, and back to the bed. Anne, I will say before Margot, Margot was a little girl that every mother would like in her home. She was very obedient, very good at school, and very good looking. Anna and me, we were exactly the other way around. Anna always wanted attention. And she did something very funny, and please, if that's not an orthopedic doctor here, don't try. She could take out her shoulder out of the socket. And then you wouldn't see it, you would hear it. It would go by knack, 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 knack. And everybody would look at Anna, and Anna was so happy. She also always would write in the breaks between the classes. She would sit like this, she would shield her notebook, and she would write. If somebody would dare to ask, what are you writing, the answer was, not of your business. So we don't know what was she writing, because the diary that me, the secretary of Mr. Frank, found, it starts 2 weeks before they went into hiding. And I speak for some years earlier. So there was another diary, and maybe it is not found. Also, Margot wrote diary, but it was never found. My mother would describe Anna real very good. She would say, God knows everything, but Anna knows everything better. And so we come to 10th of May, the invasion of the German army in Holland, and after 5 days, the Dutch had to surrender. The laws against the Jewish people that the girl was living before started slowly, slowly. But before my little sister was born, and I want to tell you about her because she's born 1940. That will say after the war, she was 4.5 years old, and I don't think there are a lot of people today that survived so young, that were so young in the war and survived. She also lives today in Israel. She has 4 children, 2 are married, and in the meantime, 7 grandchildren. And that's quite interesting to learn. And so before we always Sunday went to the office of Mr. Frank, I didn't go on Saturday to school. We were religious and Jewish people don't write at Shabbat. And Anna would go, then I took my homework, and then Mr. Frank took us to the office. The office of Mr. Frank is the museum today, the Anna Frank House, with 700,000 visitors a year. But now my little sister was born. Anna and Margot would come to our home, mother would make a bus, and then all three of us with a carriage would walk very proudly. But now it starts with the laws, and the young lady told you everything about it. She only one thing didn't mention. At the benches in the park, there was written, Jews and dogs not wanted. But all the other things she told, I don't have to say again. And at 8 o'clock, as she told, we had to be at home. And then the Germans would come, they would make up lists, and they would tell you if your name was at the list, you had to join them to come to work in a working camp in the East. They wouldn't tell us you are all being killed by gas in Auschwitz. No, this I wouldn't say. But then, when they took the people from the mentally sick home, or the old, or the babies, they all had to work in the East. And I think we believed it in the beginning somehow. Mr. Frank, the optimistic Mr. Frank, he fixed a hiding place. And we never heard about it, because things like this you never would tell anybody. The Germans could torture you, and but you didn't know, you couldn't tell. So we didn't know. And in June 42, we had a little festivity. We were already in the Jewish school. She told you we had to go out of our school. Our headmaster really was crying because she liked the children by the character and not by the religion. And we were in this Jewish school with Jewish teachers. And the end of the seventh class from Anna and me, we had a little festivity. And then there was a vacation. And after some days, I came to play again with Anna, and nobody opens the door. And I'm ringing and ringing. They had a Jewish Dutch tenant. He lived under the roof. Then he came and he opened. He knew me for 9 years. He looked at me if he had never seen me. What do you want? I said, what do I want? We have vacation. I come to play. Said, don't you know, the Frank family went to Switzerland. So I didn't know, and they didn't go to Switzerland, as we know now. They wanted this rumor to go around. They hoped that the Germans will not look for them anymore. But the Germans always looked for Jewish people. We were not allowed to go, as she said, in the trains. But they would look in the train, and they would find Jewish people, because they very often had a false identity card to go into hiding, and they would see immediately when it was not made up professionally, and they would let the Jewish people out of the train and from all over. I would think they have nothing other to do, only to catch Jewish people. And then I go home, I tell my parents, the Franks are in Switzerland. We hoped it is like this. I had a grandmother in Switzerland. And why are we still at home? I'm now speaking about July 1942. My little sister was born 2 years earlier, once and 1/4 years earlier, and now my mother was a bit pregnant. She always wanted a big, big family, and it didn't work out because when I was 12 years, my little sister was born. Now she was pregnant. And in 1942, when a woman was pregnant, the Germans would leave the woman and the family at home. Isn't that nice? You could stay at home with a pregnant woman, right? You're nice people. But a baby comes to this world after 9 months, and in October again, my sister, exactly 2 years old, my mother has to give childbirth. She didn't want to go to a hospital. We had a Jewish doctor, we had a Jewish nurse, but there were complications, and my mother and the baby died by childbirth. And now we had no mother, but also no protection. And my father had to get something. You called it a stamp in our identity card that had a big J for Jew. And then we hoped, we said, we can stay at home till the end of the war. It held 8 months, but that was also something. We got two different papers, and I think it's interesting if you are already here by this rainy day, so I will tell a little longer. The first thing was, my uncle went to Switzerland and not to Holland, as we and his parents. And then, in 42, you could buy in Switzerland, in a South American consulate, a passport of one of the neutral countries. You have to understand, when we left Germany, we had to leave our passport. My grandparents came not from Poland. My grandparents, great-grandparents, they all were German. But we had to give our passport at the border. And when we came to Holland, there you have to live 10 years. But 1933, it would be 43, there was a German occupation. So we had not a Dutch passport. We were without any nationality. And now we got a passport of Paraguay. And that was quite important. It was a neutral country. But we got something else, and my family thought it's even more important. At the end, it was the same. Maybe if we had only one of the two, it would have helped also for my sister and me to survive. My father and grandparents, it wouldn't help. The second thing was like this. There were negotiations going on between Germany and England. Even there was a war in Switzerland. And the English did it out of humanitarian reasons. And the Germans wanted a very small group of Jewish people to set apart and to exchange them to Eretz Israel, Palestine, against German prisoners of war, soldiers, prisoners of war, and change list. And that was big luck, because at the end there were 40 lists, and so many Jewish people, they again didn't want to have a site. So it was just luck, our family, my family, got a place at the second list. Now it helped, I said, 8 months, 20 of June 1943, nothing helped anymore. Holland was, so I should call it, Judenrein, without Jewish people. The one in hiding you didn't see. And only people like us with a stem, also people that worked for the army, everybody at this day was taken. They closed the whole area where we lived. They went from door to door. In the Christian homes, they would look. Maybe they have a Jew in hiding. And the Jewish people, you had 20 minutes, and you could take 45 pounds of luggage. We had a very nice Christian lady, a Catholic German lady. She came to live next to us after my mother died, and she was crazy with my little sister. She always invited her, but we were not allowed to go to Christian homes. So sometimes my father would allow her because they had a sandbox, she had a little boy, and then he would look out of the window, he would see some German, and she could go and play there. This woman went down to the vents and spoke with the SS in charge. We didn't see it, I heard it after the war. And she asked him, couldn't I get at least a little girl? And he shouted at her, you, a Dutch Christian, you want a Jewish child? Aren't you ashamed? And she answers him, she says, I'm a German Christian and I'm not ashamed. The poor lady fainted, but she didn't get the little girl. Later on, she sent us a package and she put a book inside. You know, I didn't take books, the professors maybe took books. I took food and luggage. And that book I read so often that it influenced my whole life. It was about the first registered nurse in the world, Florence Nightingale. And so after the war, I had to be a nurse. And now we were brought with these vans to the central station, the railway station. There were cattle cars waiting for us, and we were brought to the Dutch camp, Westerbork. It was a transit camp to the east, as they told us always. The camp Westerbork was not so bad, but in the middle there were these rail tracks, and every week, or once or twice, would come the cattle cars. And there had to be 1,000 Jewish people inside, to work in the east. And the night before, everyone was like crazy. In this camp, you also had an orphanage. Look, the children, my sister and me, we came in that orphanage because we arrived without a mother. This Kids in the orphanage, Sabtuhata, were not orphans always. Not everybody was as lucky as the Franks and could go into hiding with the whole family. If you had little children, they make noise, babies you can't close up for so long. So the little children you would bring to farmers. Farmers have more room, have more children, and you can have more noise. And again, these children had a false identity card, and the Germans would also search in the farmers' houses. So every child they would find, they needed a place where to put it, till they decided what to do with the children. So the children sometimes had parents that were already in Auschwitz, and sometimes the parents survived without the children. So I worked in this orphanage, and the Jewish registration put all these little children also at the lists for exchange to Palestine, Israel. And so they hoped to save these little children. And 23 of November, again, this cattle cars came, and I have to tell this, this was one of the saddest nights in my whole life. And there was nobody to be sent. The camp was full, but everybody had a stamp like us. And then you had to ask the commandant, the leader of the camp, his name was Jonathan, whom are we sending this night? And he decided, I don't need 40 lists aside, I need only two. And I said before, my family was on the second list. And at that night, all the little children were sent. I remember we were some five or six that didn't go. We had to try to make a little package with a sweater, with something. We knew, we didn't know where are they going, but maybe it's cold, every child should get a package. We had a rabbi, a Jewish priest, and we have these big prayer shawls, white with black stripes. And he took a big prayer shawl over the head of these 200 children. He blessed them, but how do we say it? The answer from heaven was no. We don't get always what we are praying for. These little children, with the teachers, straight went to the gas chambers, as we learned much, much later. I tell it 1,000 times, and every time it's very hard for me. I knew the children, and in one case I even met parents after the war that I loved the children that were sent to Auschwitz. These parents found two other children from an uncle that died and took them as their own children later on. The orphanage filled very quickly again because they always would find other children. Now I come to the first, I call it miracle, that my little sister had. She had three miracles on the way. I just don't know another way. Maybe the father can tell me another word. I don't know. And what happened was, when we were 2 weeks in this orphanage, she got very sick. She got an ear infection. Today you get some antibiotics, you get a needle, and the pus can slip out, and you are healthy after 2 days. We didn't have any penicillin, but we had very good Jewish doctors because they also were in this camp. And one of them made an operation. You had to smash the bones behind the ears, and then the pus could come out. If she wouldn't have gotten this operation, the pus would have gone to her brain, and she would have died of food poisoning. So I call it a miracle that in a camp you could get the operation. It didn't heal. When we were sent to Bergen-Belsen in February, she still was with a big bandage, and it was very nice. It was smelling, because in a camp you can't change it, so always you must. I will say now, in Bergen-Belsen, it's a very bad camp, it healed after 3 months. And I asked doctors after the war, what happened? And they thought it may be because in Holland it was very humid and not cold. But in Bergen-Belsen it was very dry and very cold. And for her ears, that was the medicine. And thank to God she went to be healthy again. But so this was her first miracle. And the second was that we were in February called to this Gerbeke, leader of the camp, and he says, everybody with the Palestine papers list 1 and 2 and the passport. passports of England, America, and South America are going to a wonderful camp, an exchange camp in Bergen-Belsen, not to work in the East. In the morning, we really got a train, not a cattle car, and we felt very good. Even a piece of bread was in the train. Then we arrived at this camp, Bergen-Belsen. It was at the first moment a big shock, because there stood this German SS, like sardines, one near the other, with dogs like this. Since then, I don't like any dogs, not big ones, not small ones. I asked the lady that came to catch me, do you have a dog? First question. But I have to say, but again, only the first half year, this camp was better than all the others. We didn't know, we, after the war, when there were competition, you could hear. What was better? In all other camps, first thing you arrived, you went to the gas chambers, but if you didn't go, you were shaved and you got tattooed a number at your arm. This we didn't get. Not so important. But in all the other camps, first thing you were divided. Men somewhere in a camp, women somewhere else, children dead. Here, children stayed alive. Children stayed with father or mother. We had barracks for men, we had barracks for women, but every night the men could see the women, and that was very, very important. And then there was no killing. There were no gas chambers, there was no killing. And the luggage we brought from Holland stayed with us. We didn't get the striped clothes. So you see, funny things you have to be thankful for. And now we arrived at this new camp, and after 2 days, I got sick. I got jaundice, jaundice, a contagious sickness, and I was told I have to go to an isolation barrack. But how can I go? My little sister came straight out of the hospital and was brought to me in the train. How can I leave her with 200 strange people in a barrack? Because my father and grandmother were taken the same day we arrived for 2 weeks also to be isolated in an isolation barrack, because the Germans always were afraid of sickness. They came back after 2 weeks, but I didn't know. In the meantime, what should I do with my little sister? And what helped again? What happened was, I looked at everybody. I cannot say to somebody, please be my babysitter. Everybody that has a child was very busy to keep that child healthy. And that nobody, I think, would take a child, not of his family, with a big bandage and smelling. And then I met an old lady, Mrs. Lambert, who was a neighbor of us in Amsterdam, a very nice lady, and she saw I'm like crazy, and she asked what happened, and I told her. And she said, you know, maybe I can help you. She went out and came back with a niece of her, a very religious Jewish woman that had 7 children of her own, 2 boys with her husband and 5 girls with her. And she said, you know, your father always helped everybody, now it's my turn. And I think that's a miracle, because I didn't find one with one child, but she had 5 girls with herself. And she took my little sister for a whole month till I was healthy. And then she said, you will change to your barrack, you also come to live with us, we are one big family. This woman, her husband and her oldest son died in Germany after liberation from pipes. The other children, 6, were saved, 3 are in Israel and 3 are still in England. I say still, I hope. And then we come to the third miracle my sister had, because I cannot say this or this, altogether saved her life. Why did it become hell in this camp? If I meet some survivors and I tell about milk, they think I'm crazy. What are you talking about milk? No milk and even no food. But the first half year it was better. So what happened now? There was a D-Day. The Americans came to France to conquer from the West Germany. The Russians came from the East. The Germans didn't want any eyewitnesses. They took out of the camps everybody that could still walk. They put him to walk. Sometimes in open trains. They had wooden shoes. There were no dress coat, only this striped clothes, and almost no food. The real dying people, they left in Auschwitz. And the group in between that was not dying but couldn't work anymore would come to our camp in Bergen-Belsen, what is very far from Auschwitz. And these people arrived quite three-quarter dead. But why did they die like flies in Bergen-Belsen? There was another reason. If you live under these conditions, we had only cold water to wash ourselves. We, that had better conditions, got twice a year a warm shower. Twice a year, or twice a day, not a week, not a month. We had to wash ourselves with cold water with open doors. Then you are just not washing yourself every day. In Germany it's very cold, I think here also. And then everybody had lice. Lice at the head and lice in the seams of the clothes. And the people that came from Auschwitz, they had lice, but these lice were infected by typhus. And when they arrived with this lice, they just got typhus and more don't need. And we, every time there came new people, got less food. The lice were there, we were here, but they came under the barbed wire, they wouldn't mind, took a day longer, they had time. And now we also started to die like flies. My sister never got typhus, I never got typhus, but I got twice typhoid. That is not so bad as typhus, I'm sitting here. But typhus, thank to God, I didn't get. And now again, there comes a whole group, only women, 7,000 women, but the whole camp is full. The people didn't die quick enough. I only once saw a mountain with dead bodies. They had to burn. They couldn't burn them so quickly. So they put these women near where we were at an open field. They built, or they let build, very big tents, and there they put the 7,000 women inside. Now they were very near to us, but again, we couldn't speak with them, and we didn't know from where are they, did they meet our family, what happened to them. And what happened was, in November 1944, a very windy and rainy night, all the tents blew down, and the women, it were only women, were sitting in the water. Then the next day, my part of the camp got the order to decrease. We stayed with 10 barracks and 10 for these 7,000 women. Now they really were very near because the barracks you saw in the pictures were always very near. But again, we couldn't speak with them because it was not allowed. The Germans put up or let build it, I don't remember, a very high fence with barbed wire, and they put round straw in between, so we couldn't look through. And at the top, there were watch towers with German soldiers, I don't think it was SS, and they had a rifle. People are people, and we wanted to know who are they. We couldn't speak with them. We hear only Czechish and Polish, and we were from Holland, we were from Germany, from Greece, and we also had some colored Jewish people from Libya. I say colored people because we have everything. We have Jewish people in all the colors you have also. We are also married together. My sister, son-in-law, is a colored young man from Persia, a Jewish colored man from Persia. We don't mind. The main thing is the character. And so these people, couldn't speak with them. And then we learned there are 40 Dutch women between this group, what was left of the 7,000 women. They came nearer the fence, they heard that our part spoken Dutch. And in February 45, it took us 4 months, it was so dangerous, somebody told me, you know your friend Anne Frank, she is here next to you in the camp. And I really got crazy because I hoped the whole time Anne Frank is in Switzerland and has fun with her grandmother. And now I hear she's next to me in even worse conditions than me. So I have no choice. At night I went near the fence. I start to call over very carefully and a The women that answered me was the women that was in hiding with the Franz, Mrs. Van Pels, in the old diary of Mrs. Van Daan, and the mother of Peter, Anne's boyfriend. And she knew me, I knew her. She says, oh, you want Anne? I said, sure. And she only answered me, Margot, I cannot bring to you. She is so weak, she even cannot walk till this fence. I will bring Anne. So there I stood and was waiting. It was dark and cold and raining. And then somebody is calling for me, and it was Anne. And you know, first thing, we both started to cry. And it was not the same Anne that I had known. It really was a broken little girl. And I say, how do you come here? I hope you are in Switzerland. And then, very short, she told me, we didn't try to go to Switzerland. The borders were much too good, kept already. We went in hiding in Daddy's office. We only wanted this rumor to go around. And then we were betrayed. Then she told me about Auschwitz and gas cameras. I didn't know. That was the first time I heard the name of Auschwitz, little village in Poland, or Switzerland, never heard about. And gas, I also didn't know. I told my father, but I don't remember if he knew or not, or I don't know. He was very sick. He died 1 or 2 weeks later. I don't know what he answered me. I forgot. I'm sorry about it. And then I told her my mother died by childbirth. She knew about the baby. She didn't know about my mother. And I told her my father is dying, but my little sister, thank to God, is okay. And Anna answers me, but I have nobody anymore. And that was not true. Why did she say so? Her mother was so weak, she had to stay in Auschwitz. She died, we learned later, about 6th of January from weakness. Her sister was with her, very weak, very sick, so she knew some more days, I have no sister anymore. But you all know, if you read the diary, that Mr. Frank, her father, was the only one to survive. Why did Anne think he is dead? In Auschwitz, she saw that everybody under 15 and over 55 goes straight to the gas chambers. But there stood this Mengele or somebody else. They wouldn't ask everybody. There always came 1,000 people. How old are you? How old are you? They just would look. Somebody looked healthy. He went to the right. He can work. Somebody was maybe only 25 years old, but looked sick, went to the left, to the gas. Mr. Frank looked healthy. In hiding, they had some food. In Westerbork, in the Dutch camp, they only were 1 month. And I said before, it was not so bad in that camp. When he arrived in Auschwitz, he looked younger than 55. He looked as he can still work, and he stayed alive. And I always, not only was he alive, when I met Anne in February 1945, Mr. Frank was already liberated because the Russians liberated Auschwitz in January, 27th of January, 45. And I always think maybe if she would have known her father is alive, maybe she had a little bit more strength to survive, but we don't know. Then she says she has almost nothing to eat, if I can help. So we also had the same, almost nothing to eat. There is a Red Cross, they didn't send packages. Jewish people could die. But we had these passports of a neutral country. And one time, only one time, and exactly in February 45, everybody with the passports got 2 tiny, tiny packages. And then I met Anne. So I say, Anne, come back 2 or 3 days. I will try to do something for you. I came back with something like this, very small, but a fortune. The whole package was for us a fortune, but nothing. There were in dried prunes, there was in the Swedish knäckebröd you can keep for long. And my friends gave me a loaf or something. I came with this little package, and when I heard Anne, I said, Anne, careful, I'm throwing it over the fence. And then I hear she's crying, she's shouting, what happened? There were a lot of hungry women. I couldn't see her. The fence was high and the night was dark. Another one caught the package, ran a babysit, and didn't give her anything. I had to calm her down and I promised Anna to try again. And we did. After some days, I came again. This time she got the package. But it was the last time we spoke together. We never could still see each other. Because then my father died, I didn't go to look for her for some days. And when I looked for her again, everything was empty. These crazy Germans had nothing to do, end of the war, to send Jewish people from here to there. This Mrs. Van Pelt, she died near Berlin in Ravensbrück. Anna and Margot stayed in Bergen-Belsen, but somewhere else. Now there was a road between us, and I had no idea where she is. Now I make a big, big jump. I came back to Holland, 1st of July, 45. I had to stay near the border in a hospital. And Mr. Frank saw that I survived at a list that was published from the Red Cross. First, he went to see my little sister. She was again with the people that took all the orphans. She was healthy, thank to God. And then he came to visit me. It was very hard for him. There was nothing working in Holland, no trains, no bridges. It took him 8 hours to come, 8 hours to go back. And when he came, I was so happy. And I tell him, you know, maybe your daughter is alive somewhere in Germany. I spoke with her in February. I didn't see her, but now we are in August. So he told me that he already knew that his little daughter, the bigger daughter, and the mother will never come back. And they really never did wrong to anybody. We ourselves, we got our tiny little country, Israel, after 6 million died. I don't know, if you say 6 million, it's just nothing. But think, I heard in New Jersey, for all New Jersey are 6 million people living. So just think about it. All New Jersey wiped out, about 6 million. So the United Nations gave us a little piece of world to be for us. Now we can defend ourselves, but as you know, we have no peace till this day, and we hope you all will help us build this little country. And you shouldn't believe all the lies they tell about us in television. I just want to add a little thing, maybe I shouldn't go into politics, but last Thursday I was told from internet that the Arabs had sent an ambulance to blow up Mr. Powell when he came on the road. There was one ambulance with explosive and one man inside and one man outside. So he should blow them up, and the moment the people would come to help, he would blow up the others. So thank to God, the Israeli soldiers found this ambulance. They need ambulances with explosives. And then they tell in television, we don't let the ambulances with the sick people pass. So don't believe everything. I don't want to say anymore. Help us build our little country and believe we are not so bad as they tell about us. We just also want to survive and want a little peace and a little piece of land. Thank you.
Now returns. Anne Frank, the teenage girl whose heartbreaking diary made her a symbol of the Jewish Holocaust. This is the only moving footage of Anne Frank that has ever been found. It's July 1941. A wedding is taking place in her Amsterdam neighborhood. The wedding photographer can't resist 12-year-old Anne peeking at the bride and groom from the window of her family's second-floor apartment. 13 months later, Anne and her family go into hiding in the sealed-off attic of her father's office building. It is there that she writes the diary that immortalizes her and continues to inspire the world with its lesson of hope and perseverance in the face of evil.